See, that's where, now it flipped, now I've got that, you've got that, so that's okay, that's fine.
Okay.
All right, so today, where are we going? We're going to Florence. All right, so you guys get to go to Florence, and so this is the main cathedral, the Duomo in Florence. And the architecture is just really amazing. It's got this ornate details right here. And the interesting thing here is the dome on the inside is double layered, meaning there's an inside layer with all the mosaics on it. And then there's the outside layer, but you get to climb up in between. So don't do it if you're claustrophobic, but if you're not claustrophobic, you get to climb up and then you can climb out on here and get a beautiful view of the city. So that's a close-up, that's the inside dome. And again, there's this back stairway, you can go all the way up to the top. But I thought that the, you know, the architecture was just beautiful right there. Florence is an amazing city. This is the front of the cathedral. And also you can go to the top here of this spire. And again, you get a pretty spectacular view of the city, but gorgeous, gorgeous cathedral. This was, you know, Florence was the height of Renaissance in Italy. So beautiful, beautiful architecture. There's a close-up, look at the detail here. Some of the stonework and some of the detail on the stained glass windows here on the cathedral. All right, so today we're talking about conjunctiva. All right, so let's talk about the three different areas of the conjunctiva. What are the three different areas we talk about?
You have your bulbar, pupil, and fornicial.
All right, so we've got the bulbar lining the bulb, palpebral lining the inside surface of the eyelid, it's the inner layer of the eyelid, and then lastly, the area here in the fornix. All right, at really low power, what are these little dots right here?
You have a bunch of goblet cells.
Goblet cells. What do goblet cells do?
Mucin.
And what is mucin? Why is mucin important?
Helps the nucleus layer, the tear film, kind of overcome its own surface tension and spread evenly over the conjunctiva gland.
Exactly. So it's the innermost layer of the tear film. And if you want to come up with a word that would describe what it does, wettability. So if you look at the surface of the cornea, the surface of the conjunctiva, at really high power with electron microscopy, there's a lot of little microvilli on there. And so if you just put water on that, the water tends to just run off and not sit on the layer of tears. So if you put mucin on the inside surface, it makes it more wettable. It allows the tear film to spread more evenly. And so if you block off these goblet cells, say you've got some adhesions of the lid to the globe, say you had pemphigoid or something, even though you're making aqueous tears, they just run off and evaporate quickly. So that's what the goblet cells do. Now, I also want you to note, the goblet cells are more prevalent the further away you get from the limbus. So if you're near the limbus, where the conjunctivitis is continuous to the cornea, there's very few goblet cells. Same thing on the palpebral surface, but you get closer to the fornix, but also closer to the coracle, both medially and laterally, you start to get more and more goblet cells. That's where goblet cells are. What is the epithelium of the conjunctiva? Okay, so the stratum and squamous non-keratinized epithelium. What is this part underneath it called? The substantia propria. So the substantia propria is kind of a loose connective tissue underlying the epithelium. And then lastly, not really part of the conj, but you get a layer right next to the sclera here anteriorly. What do we call that?
Not sure.
What do we call that?
It's Tenon's
nerves. Tenon's is important because when you are removing a pterygium, for example, the disease in a pterygium is not in the epithelium, it's below the epithelium. So you don't want to remove a huge chunk of epithelium when you take off the pterygium, but you do want to remove some of the underlying Tenon's capsule and get that out of the way. All right, let's talk about some entities. What is this thing we're looking at right here?
So it's an external photograph of the left eye at the nasal limbus, there's an elevated white region. It looks like the limbal dermoid.
All right, so this is a picture. So the term limbal dermoid really confuses people. So, because you have dermoid cysts of the orbit, dermoid, and so really the proper term, this is a limbal dermal choristoma. Now, what does choristoma mean?
Oh, me. It's a proliferation, I believe, of normal tissue in an abnormal location.
And how is that different from hamartoma?
It's the opposite. So it's an abnormal proliferation of tissue in a normal location.
Yeah, so choristoma, it's still benign tissue. It's not a tumor, but it's in a location it shouldn't be in.
Yeah.
And so this is called a limbal dermal choristoma, and that way you don't get it confused with the, you know, dermoid cysts of the orbit or anything like that. If this is indeed a patient who has this limbal dermal choristoma, and it's a young, you know, adolescent, young child, what entity can this be associated with systemically?
You can have like a Goldenhar syndrome.
All right. What else would you look for if this is indeed a Goldenhar's?
It's like a auriculo-ocular kind of facial dysplasia syndrome. So you can have like malformations of the external auditory meatus or the ear lobe itself, and then kind of facial malformations as well, bony malformations of the jaw.
Okay, so what you need to know for the boards is that this is often associated with Goldenhar syndrome. So they can get these kind of preauricular skin tags, they can get these funny teeth anomalies, they can get some skeletal anomalies. All right, so this is actually the pathology on that lesion. What are we looking at right here? And what's associated with it? All right, do we normally have hair follicles at the limbus? No, so thus the name choristoma. So you'll have a dense fibrous connective tissue, but the weird thing is you can get little hair follicles growing in these. What is this stuff here at low power that you can get with these? Lydia. Exactly. So you can get little eccrine glands growing in here, which normally shouldn't be here. And then the other thing you can get that's really interesting is you can get hyaline cartilage. So these have a interesting proliferation of abnormal tissue. So these are eccrine glands sitting in the dense connective tissue, hyaline cartilage. You get all kinds of things in these choristomas. Question?
I remember like medical school learning about like teratomas. That's different. Is that...
Dermoid is kind of two cellular layers of worth of stuff proliferating. Teratomas, all three of the embryologic layers proliferating. So teratomas is kind of a super dermoid. And there's a close-up. You see that nice hyaline cartilage with the little lacunae that are in there. So I just thought it looked cool. It's not normal to have cartilage sitting at the limbus. All right, what are we looking at right here?
So it seems like an external photograph of the white, yellowish, black-like lesion that's not growing onto the cornea. It's consistent with probably like a pink-like color.
All right. So if someone is born and raised in Utah, 100% of them have a pinguecula. Why is that?
Exposure.
Yeah, exactly. So it's because the etiology of a pinguecula and a pterygium, for that matter, is UV exposure. So we're at altitude here. We've got very thin air here. We've got 300 days of sunshine. And so you get a ton of UV exposure. And that's the cause. You notice it's within the palpebral fissure. It's this little triangular shaped area. And what is this now?
Pterygium.
Pterygium. So what's the difference between the two of them?
That's the one that starts to grow.
Exactly. So pretty much the same pathology, same etiologic factors, UV exposure. And the only difference is a pterygium has actually crossed the limbus and grown onto the cornea, but still the same findings. And so when we look at the findings, what are the findings?
Yeah, so for pterygia, you would see a thinner, at the epithelial layer. And then underneath that in the substantia propria, you can see solar elastosis, and then you can also see areas of basophilic degeneration.
So the solar elastosis, it's a UV-induced breakdown of the connective tissue in the substantia propria. And when you look at it, I think of it as it looks like a frayed rubber bands. And so I don't know if you've ever seen a rubber band that was wrapped around something, it's been out in the sun for a while, and it just frays and curls up. That's what this looks like. That's why they call it elastosis. The connective tissue takes on some elastotic properties and we'll have this frayed, squiggly, elastotic look. And then this gray, smudgy look, again, is a basophilic degeneration. What is this stuff?
It could be like calcium, like chronicity.
Yeah, so if you have a long-standing pterygium, you can sometimes get calcium in them. So when you look at these with the slit lamp, you can often see little sparkles kind of underneath it, and that's the calcification. So long-term, if they're here for a while, these can calcify.
When it grows over the cornea, does it break through Bowman's?
No, usually it stays on top of Bowman's. And so when you're trying to remove these, be really careful when you're removing the head that you don't dig down into Bowman's. Try to stay as superficial as you can, because usually these will grow onto the surface of bones but not penetrate underneath it. All right, what are we looking at right here?
This is an external photograph of the palpebral conge in the right eye. It looks edematous. It almost kind of looks like cystic, and perhaps maybe like it would transilluminate if you...
All right, so yeah, that's going to be my next question. So you guys have obviously read it forward. So what you can do, you can take a Fenof head and you can just shine it right next to it. And if the light goes through and it lights up, then you know that it's cystic, as opposed to if it's dull when it goes through, then it would be solid. And so this turned out to be a cystic lesion. And what's the most important thing we need to look at on the pathology of a cyst?
The epithelium.
The lining, all right. So we look at this cyst, and sure enough, there's the lining. How would you describe that?
So that looks like a stratified squamous epithelium with goblet cells. And then
goblet cells. So what do we call this kind of cyst?
So it's just like an epithelial cyst.
Exactly. So you can get epithelial inclusion cysts. And the reason that people call them inclusion cysts is for some reason surface epithelium has been implanted underneath the epithelium in the substantia propria. So that could be a previous injury, it could be a previous surgery, but something has caused that surface epithelium to go underneath, and then it will incist and then it'll slowly grow. And because they're goblet cells normally in the conge epithelium, these goblet cells will be in here and they'll actually make mucin. So oftentimes these are mucin filled. What are we looking at right here? Let's see, I guess we're around to Abby. Okay, what exactly are we seeing that makes you say that?
There are raised bones. I'm trying to decide if they're follicular or
yeah. Sounds like papillae. So how do you tell the difference between follicles and papillae?
So papillae will have kind of a fibro, or like a centenary of blood vessels.
Okay.
I don't think these do.
Yeah, if you look right here, the blood vessels are kind of around the periphery of each of these little bumps. They're not in the center. So these bumps would be follicles. So what's the most common reason for follicles to form? What are the reasons for them to form? Okay, so allergy is one of the main reasons. What else can cause follicles to form? Viral infections. And so you really want to be concerned when you see these. Allergy is the first thing you look for, but also don't forget that viral infections, adenovirus, keratoconjunctivitis, even herpes virus can sometimes give you follicles. So you look at the follicles. What do you see pathologically? So when you look at these, exactly, it almost has kind of the appearance of a mini lymph node, and you've got these larger paler staining lymphocytes in the center, and they're surrounded by these smaller, darker staining lymphocytes in the periphery. When we look at a close-up, here you see kind of the pale lymphocytes in the center surrounded by the darker, smaller lymphocytes around it. And so this is what a follicle looks like pathologically. All right, what do we see in here and why is this different?
So here we see bumps that instead have a fibroblast report. It's more consistent with papillae.
Yeah, look at the little dot in the center. You can actually see in each of the center of these bumps, there are little vessels in the center. So these are papillae rather than follicles. What can cause papillae?
Contact lens overuse.
Okay.
Bacterial conjunctivitis.
And even sometimes allergic can do it too. But you know, but that's because technically, if you think about it, contact lens induced papillary conjunctivitis, it may be due to something in the solutions rather than the contacts. It may be something absorbed to the contacts. And so what do the papillae look like pathologically?
So it's like there's a fibrovascular report to it. And then there's the actual mound.
All right, so here's the epithelium sticking out, goblet cells in it still, and you see little fibrovascular tissue coming right up in the middle. So that forms the papillae. And of course, the ultima papillae is this. This is what we call giant papillary conjunctivitis. So we said that this could be due to
contact
lens problems. What else can cause this?
Actually, I'm not sure.
All right, anybody?
Trachoma looks a little bit different.
Trachoma can. Vernal.
Vernal.
Yeah.
Shield ulcer. Yeah.
So if you have a, say you've got an adolescent child and their eyes really get itchy in the spring, that's the name vernal conjunctivitis. You can even see these giant papillae on the inside of the lid in vernal. So key is always make sure to flip that lid when people come in with some, you know, allergic type reactions.
So for vernal, with that like superior shield ulcer they talk about, is that just from like a upper lid GPC that's coalesced?
That's what we think has happened.
Yeah,
and
it's
affects,
just rubbing.
It affects the cornea as it goes over it. Okay. What the heck are we looking at right here? Why would I be showing you this picture after that one?
There are some bumps along the limbus that I think also are. I guess it's a little hard for me to tell if it's that or follicles, but I think you can also get this in vernal conjunctivitis.
Exactly. So there is a subset of vernal conjunctivitis that they call limbal vernal. And so you can get, again, these kids that have, these adolescents that have these bumps along the limbus. And the hallmark of the vernal is just intense itching. I mean, these poor guys are just gouging their eyes out, rubbing them all the time, because this is intensely inducing of itch. And so you can get the giant papillae on the inside of the eyelid, but you can get also the bumps, the follicles at the limbus. I'm sorry, the papillae at the limbus. And so this is called limbal vernal.
So is that the same thing as the like horn tetras dots?
Yeah, same thing. All right, what are we looking at right here?
It's drawn to the lower limb. The right eye looks like a, almost like a pedunculated, elevated lesion. Smooth, maybe translucent to pink looking. So this could be a number of things. This could be some type of mass lesion, like a lymphoma. This could be a pyogenic granuloma. It could be a foreign body granuloma.
All right, so we look at the pathology and we see this at low power. What do we see in here?
Yeah, so again, like a pedunculated lesion lined by non-stratified, squamous, non-keratinized epithelium with like, looks like intralesional, like radial smoking vascular channels. So I'd be most concerned for like a pyogenic granuloma.
Pyogenic granuloma is one of those things that it's been in the literature, and it's what we use to describe it. It's one of two misnomers in ophthalmology. And so Pyogenic granuloma. What does pyogenic mean?
Fever inducing.
Fever inducing. So it means that it's infectious. Is this infectious?
No.
No. So granuloma. Jordan, what's granuloma mean?
It's like a collection of giant cells and macrophages.
Exactly. Do you have that in this entity?
Not that I can see.
Yeah. Well, and not that you, not that there are any that are in there. So that's why I say it's a double misnomer. It's a pyogenic granuloma. It's neither pyogenic nor granuloma. It's really a mass of granulation tissue. So think of it as an overabundance of granulation tissue. So if you really look at low power, all kinds of little blood vessels, little capillaries, of course, there, but you see it's kind of white. It's very, very loose, very wide. A few little fibroblasts in here, a lot of edema in there. So kind of granulation tissue. Yes? Good question. What is the second one?
When the lens,
yeah, exactly. So fecal endophthalmitis is neither endophthalmitis, you know, nor is it anaphylactic. So that's the second double misnomer you have to remember. But for conge, you remember the pyogenic granuloma, neither pyogenic nor granuloma. And here's a close-up, little budding capillaries, loose connective tissue. Now, a mix of inflammatory cells. You can get some PMNs, you can get some lymphocytes, you know, a lot of capillaries, a lot of swelling. And so again, this is kind of an exuberant reaction, a granulation tissue reaction. So patients will often have something get in there or have some previous surgery. It's almost like a keloid of the conjunctiva, if you will. All right, let's see, I guess we're back to Abby. What is this right here? What are we seeing here?
There is super injected, raised.
What would your differential be here?
Differential is more than 90, it's acrophagocytosis, could be conjunctivitis, more malignant things. Given the kind of uniform raised flat appearance, you might be concerned for like a lymphoma. Yeah.
All right, so people call this a salmon patch or a salmon look because salmon's pink, red. And so these lesions are pink or red. It's elevated, it's smooth, there's no discharge, there's no sign of infection. And you do the biopsy, what do we see here? All right, so this is very much concerning of a lymphoma, and we do some special stains, and we see that they all stain this little brown aminoperoxidase stain outlining the nuclei there. So this indeed turned out to be a lymphoma. What kind of lymphoma are the classic Hodgkin lymphomas?
B cell.
Yeah, so they're usually a small B cell lymphoma. A lot of people will further call these mucosal-associated lymphoid tumors, MALT, M-A-L-T. And so these tend to be MALT-type, low-grade, mantle zone, small cell, B-cell lymphomas. And so very similar to the B-cell lymphomas you get in the orbit. And in fact, oftentimes when you look real carefully, if you've got the Hodgkin lymphomas, you know, there's often an orbital component to it. So you want to look real carefully when you see that. What are we looking at right here?
No.
What would your concern be? So when you look, you know, people will say, well, how do you tell the difference between, say, a pterygium and something you can lose feelings? Bless you. So basically, when you look at it, when you look at a pterygium, the disease is under the epithelium. So the epithelium is very thin. You can see through it real easily. This one looks gelatinous, and you can actually see that the epithelium itself is thickened when you look here. So your concern is that this is an epithelial lesion. So what's the first thing you want to do?
Biopsy.
Actually, you'd want to take out that cataract first. Look at that. Yeah, this tumor later. So. Get that intumescent cataract out of there. Yeah, so you'd want to get a tissue diagnosis if you can. And here's another one. You can see, again, you've got a lot of vasculature here, but look, it's gelatinous. It kind of starts at the limbus, which is where often these lesions start. We'll grow somewhere under the cornea. We'll grow somewhere out here. So, again, a concern that this is an epithelial proliferation, epithelial-type lesion. Now, we do the pathology, and this is what it looks like. So, Ashley, what do we see in here?
So, we see a stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium that looks very thick.
Very thick.
And then there's also dysplastic cells within that epithelium. The basement membrane appears to be intact.
Is that important?
Yes. So, if the cells are still kind of contained above the basement membrane, it could be considered CIN. And if it's broken through the basement membrane, it would be considered a squamous cell carcinoma.
All right, so that's an important differentiating point. If the basement membrane is completely intact, the lesion is strictly intraepithelial, we call it CIN, conjunctival intraepithelial neoplasm, or you know, it's part of OSS, you know, and ocular surface neoplasm. Now, you know, people are lumpers or people are splitters. I like to be a splitter. I like to put things in its own little individual mailbox, you know, like upstairs where you get your mail. I don't like the mail all being chucked into one sack. I like it in little individual boxes. And so I remember it more easily if I do this rather than lumping them all together and just say it's surface neoplasm. So I still like to split it up. And whether or not it's strictly intraepithelial or it's gone beyond the epithelium. So we can see here once again, basement membrane completely intact, but look at the nucleoli in here. Very active, and the nucleoli go clear the heck up here. So how do we subdivide CIN?
Usually into thirds. If it's one third up from the basement membrane, mild, two thirds moderate, then full would be severe.
All right, so we do mild, moderate, severe in terms of the degree of dysplasia of the CIN. And here, it's more than two-thirds, and so this would be considered severe dysplasia. But the key is the epithelial basement membrane is still intact. None of those dysplastic cells have gone beyond the basement membrane. And here we see another one, basement membrane intact, but look at that. I mean, you can see, look at the pleomorphism. Huge cells here, smaller cells here, nucleoli, clumping of chromatin all the way to the surface. So CIN with marked dysplasia. What are we seeing right here, Jordan?
So again, external photograph of the right eye, and on the bulbar conch, there's a large thickened epithelium there, potentially some kind of calcific deposits within it. So I'd be really worried about like a squamous cell.
I agree with everything you said except calcified. I don't see any white calcium. But you definitely see this gelatinous, whitish appearance in the epithelium, growing up the limbus, onto the cornea, on the backside. So your differential again would be CIN versus actually superficially invasive squamous cell. And when you look at the pathology, what do we see here?
So now you have epithelium that looks, I mean, it's still very like acanthotic and thick, and then looks like it's actually violating the basement.
Yeah, look, here's that kind of pink squamous looking epithelium here underneath the basement membrane. And when we look at this at low power, you have these nests of these malignant squamous cells beneath the basement membrane. So this is now superficially invasive squamous cell carcinoma. What is this thing I'm showing you?
Let's see. Connective tissue with malignant appearing cells.
What is this stuff?
Is that a...
very similar to lid malignancies of this kind. That's actually a little keratin whorl. And so as these cells become malignant, they can start making keratin. And so just like a squamous cell carcinoma of the lid, you can get these keratin whorls in here. Again, look at these cells. This one's got two nuclei in it, big nucleolus, clumped chromatin. And so this invasive squamous cell carcinoma can often have these keratin whorls, keratin pearls. And here you can see this is actually the underlying sclera right here. And you can see that this invasive squamous cell carcinoma has gone all the way to the episclera and even to the surface sclera. And so you can take a, you can see that. So it's so pretty much a really invasive squamous cell carcinoma of the conjunctiva. What is this structure, Lydia? And why would I be showing you this? And why would I show you a nerve after I just showed you squamous cell of the conj? Exactly. So when you have these superficially invasive squamous cell carcinomas, they can invade back into the orbit, but then sometimes they actually go into the nerves. And so you can get them along the inferior orbital nerve, you get them in the nerves, and they can gain access behind the orbit.
Are they typically painful?
They can either be painful initially, and then it can really kill off the nerve, and then you can have some focal areas of numbness. So you want to check for both. So here again are these tumor cells here along the nerve. So you really want to remember that these invasive invasive squamous cell carcinomas can spread via the nerves.
Is there a particular reason or characteristic with squamous cell or adenoid-cystic carcinoma that caused it to have that preference for?
I do not know the answer to that question. That's a good question. I'm sorry. I don't know what exactly it is about that tumor that does it, but it's interesting. It's that particular tumor. So don't have the answer for you. So now I can do whatever lectures usually do. Well, doctor, look that up and report back to us next week. I'm sorry, I don't know the answer to that question. But just remember that when the squamous cells do spread, they do spread via nerves. All right, so what are you looking at right here?
So this is an external photograph of the left eye. Here's some superficial pigmentation. Here's the lipis, almost 360. And then, more temporally, seems like some pigmentation that's deeper, potentially into the sclera itself.
Okay, so why would I be showing you this picture? What is it that's important about this picture? You actually described what's important about this picture.
Location of the pigment.
Yeah, some of it is deep and some of it is superficial. So that's why I wanted to show you. So it's not uncommon that you'll have pigment, especially at the limbus in people who are darker. People who are darker pigmented, you can often get, in fact, limbal pigmentation here. You could even get superficial pigmentation here, but look at that. That, instead of being brown, instead of being tan, that looks almost kind of grayish. And so that's a sign of a deeper pigmentation. That's why I like this picture. It kind of differentiates the two. So what if you have a patient, ignore this, and they've got this deeper pigmentation here? What does that mean?
It's consistent with like oculocutaneous melanosis.
Exactly. So you can get oculocutaneous melanosis. And what's interesting is the pigmentation is deep. It's not on the surface of the eye. So you don't get melanoma of the conj in oculocutaneous melanosis. Rarely you can get melanoma of the sclera. Very uncommon, but it can occur. And so oculocutaneous melanosis, it's a deeper pigment. It's a pigment underneath the sclera, and that's why it looks gray rather than brown. So I just wanted to show you that. That's what the oculocutaneous melanosis looks like. All right, now, what the heck is this? It kind of looks, maybe it's a little bit tan, a little bit pigmented. What would you be concerned about here?
Concerned about this, possibly tan.
What if I tell you this person is 12?
More likely a nevus.
All right, so more likely a nevus. Now, what's interesting is if you take the history from the parents, and again, I'll say the mom, I'm being sexist here, do dads bring kids in? Virtually never, it's always mom. You know, if, for a dad to bring them in, this growth has to be coming out of the orbit. The mom will usually say, you know what, this has been there for a while, it was pink, but now it's changing. And so now it's more tan in color, maybe it's even growing a little bit. And so it's not uncommon in these nevi that they'll look pink initially, and then as the kids hit adolescence, you know, they'll hit beginning of puberty, adolescence, these will start to pigment more and they may even will grow more, and then they'll be more concerned about it. Now we look at the pathology here. Let's see. Question.
Is that the same response to hormones?
Exactly. It's a hormonal response. And now we're seeing that earlier and earlier and earlier. And so you're seeing now kids are starting puberty younger and younger and younger age. It's all nutritional. And so as you know, nutrition is getting better and better and better, kids are going into puberty a lot sooner. My other theory, if you're a conspiratist, is it's the growth hormones that they give to the cattle, you know, to make them grow, somehow they get in there and make the kids grow more too. Now, don't quote me on that. But I love, there's conspiracies all over the place that they use hormones on cattle and that's affected people. So, but in any event, puberty is coming on earlier and earlier, and so these lesions are starting to grow earlier.
One more question. Is there a difference between like a nevus and a preclicula? Because, you know, if you see it in an open person, it might seem kind of similar.
If you look right here, you can, you know, in a pinguecula pterygium, you know, it's a subepithelial lesion and you see a lot of connective tissue. So it's white, it's dense, it's thick. These tend to be more translucent and you can actually see through them more, almost like you would see in a CIN. And so this is definitely, you can differentiate that pretty easily from a pterygium. Now, we're looking at this at low power. This is actually that young lady. So what do we see in here?
The epithelium is thicker with melanocytes, and then there's also these large cystic structures within the epithelium.
If you look right here, what do you think those cysts can be?
Those look like goblet cells, so I would be thinking epithelial inclusion cysts.
Exactly. So you can get, not uncommonly, in these nevi that are there long-standing, maybe even congenital, and then they start to grow, you'll often get little epithelial-lined cysts within them. So here's how you remember it. Which embryologic layer do melanocytes come from?
Neurocrest.
So these melanocytes, they migrate out from the neurocrest, they go to the junction between the epithelium and the substantia propria, they start to grow, and then as they're dropping down into the subepithelial substantia propria, they grab epithelium and yank them down with them. Now, don't tell the examiner when you do oral boards that story, but that's how you remember them. And so this is how you remember those melanocytes grab that epithelium and yank it down with them. And so basically, if you see one of these that are congenital in nature or very young in age, they will often have epithelial-lined cysts between the nests of melanocytes. All right, so we're looking right here. Brandon, what are we seeing right here?
So it looks like the nests are kind of confined to the epithelium. Maybe there's a little bit of junctional component, but I'm not super convinced. So I would say this is, a compound component. So I would say this is a junctional.
Exactly. So the melanocytes will start to grow at the junction between the epithelium and the substantia propria. So you'll see these nests of melanocytes here at the junction. So we call this a junctional nevus. All right, Jordan, what are we seeing here? Is this different?
So now you see nevus cells both above and below.
All right. So again, here's those epithelial cysts. You see melanocytes here at the junction. And down below in the substantia propria, what do we call this lesion?
It's a compound.
So compound nevus, both junctional and subepithelial. Now it's important because if there's junctional You know, still activity at the junction, there's still technically a risk for this going on to melanoma. So both the junctional nevus and a compound nevus could technically still go on and form melanoma. Once you lose that connection with the junction, you lose the malignant potential. All right, so Abby, what would we call this? Exactly, so this is strictly subepithelial. There's really no dermis in the con, so dermal nevus is not proper, but subepithelial nevus, so you can get nevus cells under the epithelium. Once they've lost that junctional connection, they've lost their malignant potential. All right, Lydia, we're looking at this lesion right here. What do we see in here?
Pigmented lesion like nevus.
All right, so you'd be concerned here, you know, this person is a Caucasian, so you wouldn't have the racial pigmentation, but you do see this little focal area. It's not thickened, it's this dusting of pigment. Now, I tell you this story every year, but I love this story. So this was a woman in her 40s, very, very nervous about this lesion. And in fact, on a scale anxiety of 1 to 10, she was a 12. And I said, ma'am, we're going to photograph this. We're going to have you come back again in 6 months. If it's growing, if it's changed, then we'll just go ahead and we'll just remove it. And but let us know if it grows. So she said, okay. So I'm sitting home. It's like, you know, 8 at night. And this is when we had pagers. And the resident on call pages me and said, did you see Mrs. So-and-so today? I said, yeah, I did. Well, she called tonight. It's growing. And so she was totally convinced that that was growing and it was a tumor. So we took it off. And the good news is I got to see this lesion pathologically. All right, so what are we seeing right here? So what would we call this? Actually, this is the second three-word term you have to know for conj path.
Primary.
It's a PAM, primary acquired melanosis. And this is primary acquired melanosis. We further subdivide it into...
With or without ATP.
With or without ATP. So what would this one be?
Without.
Without ATP. So if you look at this, these benign melanocytes are right along the basilar layer. They're not extending into the epithelium. There's no dysplastic features to them. So this is PAM without atypia. Now, racial melanosis, limbal melanosis, looks exactly the same. So this is PAM, primary acquired melanosis without atypia. You see these benign melanocytes along the basilar layer of the epithelium. So PAM without atypia. What are you seeing right here, Ashley?
So there are multiple areas near the temporal limbus of pigmentation, kind of an irregular pattern. I guess that's mostly what I'm seeing.
So, you know, you'd be concerned here because this is not just flat, like a little dusting of pigment. This has got some thickness to it. It's got some irregularity of the borders. It's right here at the limbus. So you'd be a little more concerned about this lesion. And then we do the biopsy of this lesion, and what do we see here?
This.
Let's pretend that this picture is strictly in the epithelium.
Okay, so in that case, this looks like it would be PAM with atypia.
Exactly, so this is PAM with atypia. So you look at the melanocytes in there, they have atypical features. There's nucleoli in them. There's pleomorphism in them. They're spreading throughout the epithelium. But if they're still within the epithelium, this becomes PAM with atypia. All right, now we're seeing a lesion here. What's our concern here?
Can I ask a quick question about the last one?
Mm-hmm.
If that's okay. So I know pathologically, PAM without atypia looks similar to racial melanosis. But isn't there, I mean, a distinction between like PAM without atypia is typically Caucasians, unilateral, versus racial melanosis is typically bilateral?
Exactly. They're different entities, but
right.
They look the same.
But they're not, yeah.
They're not
the
different
same.
Pathologically.
Yeah.
They look the same. All right, so what do we see in here? I mean, sorry. What do we see in here?
Yeah, so you have external photograph of the right eye. Looks like you have some pigmented lesions. You can see on the bulbar and palpebral and fornicial conge. You can see some fornicial shortening and starting with some blepharon.
Is this a concern?
For like melanoma, prior resection, probably.
So this patient's probably had previous surgery. You can see these areas, likely PAM, and some blepharon starting to form. But when you see pigment like that in the fornix, and Dr. Patel really stresses this, he pounds that into you, that when you see this lesion in the fornix, it's melanoma until proven otherwise. So you really want to make sure that that's not melanoma. So let's say you went ahead and you did the biopsy here. And if you look right here, here's that PAM. Oops. So now the melanocytes have gone below the basement membrane. So this has gone from PAM with atypia to melanoma. Yes?
The same kind of applies to you. You see, I mean, not like a lesion, but cornea. It was like the fornix and the
Well, you can get pigmented lesions in the caruncle, but they're very distinct, they're very round, they're nevi. But if you've got a diffuse lesion, especially deep, it's almost like the fornix. You want to be concerned for melanoma until proven otherwise, but deep. So if you look right here, here is primary choroid melanosis, boom, malignant melanoma. When you look at it, this could be pretty nasty. Look at that cell. That's a nasty looking cell. Big nucleus, clump chromatin, big cellular body, these huge cells here. So this is malignant melanoma. All right, that's really important because let's say, Jordan, you've got 100 malignant melanomas of the conjunctiva. What's the most common cause of that, the most common underlying leads to melanoma?
I believe PAM with atypia.
What percentage?
80.
Yeah. Okay, so remember, there's only three percentages you have to learn in medicine, 15, 45, and 80. So if you think it's rare, you say 15. If you think it's in the middle, you say 45. If you think it's a lot, you say 80. So this actually turns out to be 80. And so about 80% of malignant melanomas of the conjunctiva arise from pre-existing PAM with atypia. 10 to 15% arise from a pre-existing nevus. And the other five, we sometimes don't find it. But it doesn't mean 80% of PAM with atypia goes on to melanoma. It's 80% of melanomas arise from previous PAM with atypia. And here's one of the special stains you can do to confirm that those are indeed melanocytes. And there's some aminoperoxidase stains that tell you that they are melanocytic in origin, if there's a question. And this is what can happen if you don't take care of these. This was a patient at the VA, and you can see this huge pigmented lesion growing here. And this patient did have documented PAM with atypia previously and then just, you know, refused to come back for follow-up. So you can see this huge lesion at this point. You know, this required an exoneration and he had metastatic disease. All right, questions on melanomas?
Yeah, just like externally on exam, can you tell the difference between like PAM with versus without atypia? I guess I'm just wondering.
Let's look now. Right here, here's our PAM without atypia. It's a dusting. There's no thickening to it. There's no irregularity to it. It's almost like somebody took some pigment and just dusted underneath the epithelium. Whereas if you see a PAM right here with atypia,
yeah,
you see the irregularity, the thickness, the feathering of the borders. And so this is really suspicious for PAM with atypia. Those are the things that you look for.
For conge and eyelid melanoma, once it's biopsy proven, do you still do like the liver and lung workup, although these spread via like lymph to head and neck?
Yeah, you still want to go ahead and get some scanning of, especially of the liver. And this is one of the stained glass windows at the Duomo of the Cathedral in Florence. All right, any other questions, conge in general? You guys know it all. All right, have a good Thanksgiving, and we'll see you next Tuesday.